أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما. يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك، يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك، يا أرحم الراحمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today, my dear students, we will be doing chapter 9 in our hadith book. It's quite a long heading, which reads as following: Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Babun fi tafakkuri fi 'azimi makhluqatillahi ta'ala. Babun fi, the chapter regarding at-tafakkur, pondering fi, regarding or pondering in 'azimi makhluqatillah. عظيم, in the immense makhluqat, creation of Allah Ta'ala. And also, وَفَنَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. So the chapter regarding pondering in the immense creation of Allah and فَنَاءِ الدُّنْيَا, and the fana, the passing nature of the dunya, of this worldly life. وَأَهْوَالِ الْآخِرَةِ, and the misfortunes of the year after. وَسَائِرِ, and the rest. Umurihima, of their matters, the rest of the matters of the dunya and the akhirah. So it's the chapter regarding tafakkur, regarding pondering, regarding thinking deeply, scrutinizing. And furthermore, the heading goes as follows, and it's also about pondering in what? Wa taqsirin nafsi, and regarding the taqsir. The taqsir means to be short. So taqsir, the negligence of the nafs, of the soul, of the nafs. وتهذيبها, and disciplining it. وحملها, and carrying it or urging it. على الاستقامة, towards steadfastness. So it's quite a lengthy heading over there for the bab, but basically the essence of what it captures is that it's regarding tafakkur, it's regarding pondering and thinking deeply regarding the ayat of Allah, the signs of Allah within creation and also within the self, and pondering with regards to the egotistical nature of the self and how we have a duty to actually subdue the soul which we have been gifted with. We'll start inshallah immediately. Sorry about that. قال الله تعالى. Allah Ta'ala says in the first verse, إنما أعظكم بواحدة. قل, say to them, O Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, إنما, only, أعظكم, I advise you. So say to them, I only advise you, بواحدة, of one thing. Say to them, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I only advise you of one thing. What is this one thing? أن تقوموا لله, that you should, قام يقوم, that you should stand, لله, for Allah. And it's not literally referring to the position of standing versus sitting. It's referring to the idea of standing with honor and with dignity, with confidence, with courage, to adopt that stance. Standing adopts a much more active stance than sitting, which is quite passive. So the Quranic verse is saying, be completely dynamic in your quest for the truth. Don't just sit there and lie down and expect things to happen. So I advise you of one thing. What is this one thing? Stand for Allah. Have a firm resolve, a firm determination, right? Have that fervor. Resolve, have that resolve for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it describes mathna, coming from the word ithnain, in pairs, wa furada, and alone, and by yourself, like mufrad, the number mufrad, right? It's singular. So stand for Allah, how? Pairs, in pairs, wa furada, or alone. What does that mean? That means that when you actually have the courage and the bravery to stand up, to scrutinize things, to actively try to make meaning and to try to make sense of the world that you are in, there are two ways in which you can arrive at whatever conclusions you arrive at. You can either do it mathna, two or more, so within a group, You know, sometimes you ask people questions or you discuss certain things or you go to classes and then your understanding shifts. But this can also be happen, and you can also come to these realizations furada, alone. Some people contemplate by themselves, and through this process they also arrive at truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala basically describes the two ways in which a person can come to the truth, either alone or with others. The one thing that we need to be aware of here is also the idea of a crowd mentality, or of groupthink, as they say. And some commentators even mention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention a group here specifically, also to alert us to the fact that within a group dynamic, there are often many power dynamics and many different, you know, hierarchies and such. And because of that, sometimes that hierarchy or just that element and that power play in the group can actually impede your ability to arrive at truth. So the idea of groupthink is a very it's a very common concept which we know about, and we can see it that when you are in a group, you are more likely to accept what the entire group says, because to actually stand out in the middle of that entire crowd of people is extremely challenging, and only a few bold people would do that. And that's why Allah says, that's the advice given in the beginning of the verse, antaqumu lillah, stand up for Allah, you know, have that firm resolve, be bold for the sake of Allah. Okay, so once you have now come to your conclusions, or say, for example, you are in this process of scrutiny, of deeper thought, then the verse is, ثُمَّ then تَتَفَكَّرُوا, then you must ponder, then you must make fikr. And that's basically telling you that once you have gathered your evidences, either from your own mind or from what you have learned from people or whatever you have discussed with others, you have to now take that and you have to reflect and you have to ponder. You have to think deeply regarding those things. And that's basically the process which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outlines here, where Allah instructs the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell us, I only advise you of one thing. Use this process to arrive at the conclusion of truth, and we make dua that we are able to reflect and to ponder deeply. And fikr also happens when one uses the creation of Allah to come to certain realizations, right? So dhikr often uses, you know, you make dhikr within yourself, or you make dhikr reflecting on the attributes of Allah or the names of Allah. But when you make fikr, you also scrutinize and you think deeply about the world around you, about the ayat of Allah, all the various things that He has created. And this also is quite powerful enough to help you to arrive at truth, subhanAllah. And this is what the chapter's heading is all about. It's regarding pondering in the immense creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and then the second verse Allah mentions in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, it's at the end of the surah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, indeed, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ, and in the alternation of the day, of the night of the layl first, وَالنَّهَارِ, and the day, there are لَآيَاتٍ, there are definitely signs, لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ, for the possessors of intellect, for the possessors of wisdom. And who are these ulil albab? Allah describes them. Alladhina yadhkuruna Allah. They are those who remember Allah qiyaman wa qu'udan, whilst they are qiyam, standing, wa qu'udan, and sitting, wa ala junubihim, and on their sides when they are reclining, wa yatafakkaruna, and they ponder, they scrutinize, fi khalqi as-samawati wal-ard, they ponder regarding the creation of the heavens and the earth. And because of the dhikr that they make at all times or whenever it's possible, plus the fikr within the creation of Allah, what conclusion does it naturally lead them to? It leads them to the idea that they say the following, رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا, رَبَّنَا, O our Rabb, مَا خَلَقْتَ, you have not created هَذَا, this, بَاطِلًا, in vain, سُبْحَانَكْ, Glory be to you, how perfect you are. فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. So save us from the punishment of the fire. SubhanAllah. We learn many things in this verse about the possessors of intellect, is that they are those who possess the ability to make dhikr in all types of circumstances, and they also have the ability to make fikr. These two elements are basically the contributing elements to wisdom and to us receiving this lub, or this intellect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about. Also, just about these verses, these are the concluding verses of Surah Ali Imran. There are a few more verses after this. And within these verses, there's a reason of revelation, a sababun nuzul. And this is where the companions once sat with Sayyidina Aisha after the demise of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as they used to ask the mothers of the believers, they asked her, tell us something about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was the most amazing thing. You know, tell us something really amazing about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Aisha radiallahu anha replies, all of these matters were amazing, subhanAllah. But she said, I will relate one incident to you. So she mentions that one night they were together and they were relaxing a bit together. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks her and he says, permit me to worship my Rabb. So he has the beautiful etiquette and the adab to ask, or not to ask for permission, but just to inform her delicately and gently that he is going to spend some time with his Rabb. And he does this and he gets up, he performs his wudu, he performs his salah, and he stands in salah and he cries to such an extent that his beard actually becomes completely wet because of his tears, his blessed tears, subhanAllah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remains like this until Bilal comes to actually make the adhan for Fajr. And Bilal radiallahu an, he comes in and he sees the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this state. And he says, have you not been forgiven for all of your previous sins and your future sins? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, yes, but I should behave as a grateful slave. And then also he says, and why should I not be in this state when on this night a special series of verses were revealed to me? And he mentions then these verses of Surah Ali Imran, which we just translated. And then he says, waylun liman sami'ahun. He says, woe to the one who listens to these verses, wa lam yatafakkar fihin, but they do not ponder regarding these verses. So these are a beautiful selection of verses filled with many, many wisdoms and lessons for us, inshallah. We move to the next set in Surah Ghashiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again also alerts us to the fact that there are so many miracles within His creation. Allah mentions here, أَفَلَا يَنظُرُونَ. So do they not look إِلَى الْإِبِلِ, to the camel, كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ, how it was created. And obviously this is to an Arab audience at that time, and they knew the camel very, very well. They knew the reliability of the camel. They knew the gentle nature of the camel, such that even a child could lead the camel. They knew that the camel was so perfectly suited to the desert terrain because it didn't need to drink water. It was suited to the sandstorms. Also with regards to just the, you know, the height of the camel actually has two knees. So when he lowers himself for you to sit on his back, then it's amazing to even just watch that process unfold. So Allah says, do you not look and do you not see the camel that we have created and how this animal just wanders through the desert? SubhanAllah. They call it the ship of the desert. And then وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ, and do you not look to the heavens, to the skies, كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ, how it was raised. Again, because they were desert dwellers and desert travelers, they had a very, very good, a keen understanding of the night sky as well, and of the sky in general. You know, they were very connected to these things. And Allah says, don't you look at these things? Don't you wonder who created this, how this came to being? It couldn't just be like this. You couldn't have this entire navigation system in the stars without there being some careful, you know, deliberate planning behind it. وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ, do they not look to the jibal, to the mountains, كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ, how it was erected. You know how it was made to stand firm, to be like these pigs which stabilize the ground. وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. Do they not look to the earth how we have spread it out, how it was spread out before us with all of its splendor and all of its benefits. فَذَكِّرْ. So remind, continue to remind. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ. You are only one who reminds. And we are reminded here of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's mission, which was to remind, but he could never ever force the truth on any person. And that is a lesson for us as well, is that sometimes we so badly desire for someone to just believe something or for someone to see something within a situation. And if it's not their time, and if it's not put out by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if it is not set out in the qadr, then you can't make it happen. You need to wait and you need to be patient and just continue to dhakir, to remind and to remind, because that is your role, inshallah. And the last verse which is mentioned in this chapter before we do the hadith, in Surah Muhammad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. So do they not travel فِي الْأَرْضِ in the earth, فَيَنْظُرُوا, so that they can look. Do they not travel in the earth so they can see, so that their eyes can be opened, so that they can see how various nations ended up? What was the plight of these nations? What happened to them? How did they end up? What were the actions like? Were they grateful people? And for us to actually study history is very, very important. But even to visit and to walk in these places is even more eye-opening, because to see entire nations who were perhaps destroyed or entire nations who prospered, it's very, very interesting to see and to look into these different lessons which history offers us. So Allah says, أَفَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَيَنْظُرُوا. Do they not travel in the earth so that they can look? SubhanAllah. And in this chapter, there's only one hadith, and it is the following one over here. Beautiful hadith to memorize. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. An Abi Ya'la Shaddad ibn Aws radiyallahu anhu an an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the kayyis, the intelligent person, the intelligent person is, and if we just look at the word kayyis means the one who is aqil, the one who possesses intelligence, so he's not overtaken by emotion. His aql can actually stabilize him, especially in times when he is overtaken by emotion. That aql actually comes and restrains, right? So that's the kayyis. And also it's a person who possesses basira, a person who possesses insight. What does insight mean? Insight means that you are able to look further than what is happening right now, and you are able to actually just see the outcome and the consequences of actions. This is not an easy thing, because most people, they see exactly what is in front of them and they fail to actually look beyond. So the kayyis is the one who is aqil, and at the same time is the one who has basira. He has this insight. He can see the consequences of actions, or he can look forward. He can act not just for today, but he can act for his future. So that's the kayyis. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the truly intelligent, the truly kayyis person is who? Man, the one who dana nafsahu, the one who dana, the one who takes to account, the one who subdues, the one who subjugates. He subjugates or subdues what? Nafsahu, his soul, his nafs, right? Himself. And this refers to the lower self, the ego, if you'd like to call it that. So the truly intelligent person is the one who realizes that his nafs can be an opponent to him, and he actually subdues that nafs. He trains that nafs, because he realizes that as you give the nafs power, the nafs exerts its authority over you. SubhanAllah. And it's a, you know, we basically in Ramadan, and that's exactly what we are doing, is we are subduing our nafs. You know, it's something that we find it's a difficult concept. We imagine staying away from food and drink and other pleasures for 30 days, but we can do it. And that just shows the immense self-control that the nafs does have when you actually call on that self-control, when you actually train that nafs, when you present it with certain challenges. So it's a very, very important practice to challenge your nafs from time to time with regards to screen time, with regards to social media, with regards to the things that we eat. It's very, very good to train your nafs and to actually to subdue your nafs so that it realizes that you are in control of it. SubhanAllah. There's a lovely quote which also says that if you have a good wolf and you have the bad wolf, right, which one will gain in power? Which one will become strong, right? And then the answer is the one that you feed. So if you are feeding the bad wolf, then that one will obviously, you will obviously gain power. You will gain strength over you. But if you are always feeding the good wolf, then that one will be the one who is victorious, inshallah. So our nafs is the same. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that the kayyis, the truly intelligent, the one who has insight, is the one who subdues his nafs. وَعَمِلَ, right? Why does he do this? وَعَمِلَ, and he acts, lima, for that which, بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ, for that which is after death. SubhanAllah. We just define the kayyis as the one who possesses insight. He can look beyond what is happening in front of him right now. And to act for what is after death, that is the greatest measure of insight, because death is basically one of the outcomes of this dunya, your death and how you die and what that means for you. So if you are able to prepare for that, you have truly shown that you are al-kayyis, when you are one who resists the impulse to just act and to just run after your desires on a whim. If you are able to control yourself between stimulus and response, that means that you are building yourself up to becoming al-kayyis, inshallah. And then we learn about the opposite end of this as well. And we make dua that we are of the kayyis, inshallah, of the intelligent. But you also get wal-ajiz, the ajiz. They translate it as the foolhardy. You can say the negligent, the weak, the unable, the ajiz person. Who is this person? This is man, the one who atba'a nafsahu. Atba'a is on the fourth bab, right? Atba'a yutbi'u, to cause to follow. So tabi'a on the first bab just means to follow, and atba'a means to cause to follow. So the ajiz person is the one who makes follow. He causes what to follow what? He causes his nafs, he causes himself, right, to follow hawaha, its desires. SubhanAllah. So he makes his nafs run after his temptations or his desires, and he thus fulfills it immediately. And he is the one who is in control. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is letting you know that you are in charge. You have been gifted with this amana. You have been given this responsibility. You make the choices. Nothing coerces you into acting or behaving in a certain way. It's all your choice. So the ajiz, if you choose to be of the ajiz, then you are of those who makes your nafs follow its desires, its temptations. The word hawa, hawa means your desire. It also comes from the word hawa, which means air. And your desires are like air, they evaporate. You know, after wanting something so badly and after getting it, then it's like it's gone. It has disappeared into thin air, even though that thing has ruled your mind for the last few hours or the last few weeks. Once you fulfill the desire, it's empty and it's gone. SubhanAllah. So the ajiz, the unable person or the negligent person, is the one who makes his nafs follow its desires. Wa, whilst, tamanna, whilst he has false hopes. Allah, in Allah, subhanAllah. What does that mean? Some of the ulama say that it means yudhnibu, that the person sins, right? Like dhamb. Yudhnibu wa yatamanna al-jannah. And yet he falsely hopes for jannah min ghayri istighfar, without any istighfar, without actually making amends for his actions or making any tawbah. So it's a person who sins, but he thinks that he will enter Jannah despite all of his sins and also without acknowledging that he has committed them. So without making istighfar, without repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is tamanni, this is wishful thinking. These are false hopes in Allah. Because look, we all sin, but the first thing we have to do when we commit a sin is we need to acknowledge that we have sinned. We need to acknowledge our shortcomings. We need to acknowledge how we have fallen short in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We repent and then we carry on. That's how life is. But we can't be like this person, the Ajiz, who continues to sin over and over repeatedly, but yet he thinks that he will just automatically be granted entrance into Jannah. May Allah protect us from such thoughts, and may Allah grant that we act intelligently with our resources and with our time, with our skills, with our heart, with our minds. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah make us amongst the truly intelligent and the insightful ones. May Allah grant that we all are able to derive the best out of this calamity that we are facing at the moment. And may Allah keep us and our families safe. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Let's recite our dua together. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.